How's it going, everybody? Today we are going to be covering arrays. What exactly is an array? Well, arrays are a type of variable that can store multiple variables of the same type inside it, right? So they are grouping a whole group of variables together. Now, this is useful if you want to store many variables in the same category without having to declare each of those variables. An example where you would use an array is, let's say you've got 5 classes of 25 students. Now imagine having to create 125 string variables to store the names of the students. That would just be way too much coding. So instead, you can create 5 arrays of 25 strings each, and then you can store each class's students in each of the arrays. And then you can access each class list individually because the class lists are grouped into their respective arrays. So now we're going to look at how we create an array. This is an example of an array data type. So you would declare it under variable within your procedure, or you can also make it a private array or a public array, depending on how you're needing to use it. When we create the array, we need to give it a name, and the prefix we use is ARR. We go semicolon, type the word array, and then in square brackets, we put the lower index and the upper index, and we say of, and then the variable type. So you cannot store variables that are of different types in the same array. So they must all be one variable type, such as string, or you can do integer, or char, or boolean, and so forth. Then the lower and upper indices, or indexes, are the names that you want to allocate to each of the variables that you're going to put in there. So if we do 1 to 12, then that means we're going to have variables that we're going to call 1 all the way up until 12. So we're going to have 12. So let's look at an example or a more graphical explanation of how arrays are structured. So over here, we've got an estate, and it's called Donut Mansions because inside the estate, we have a whole group of mansions. Okay. So because it's Donut Mansions, that means we don't have apartment blocks and houses and mansions and lodges and so forth in here. We only have mansions in this estate. Okay. So you can think of Donut Mansions as the array, and inside there are only mansions. Okay. Then the mansions each have house or have numbers, right? Because when you ring the doorbell, you want to click on the number that you want to go to. So if we want to go to number 3, we need to know that the house, the mansion, is called 3. And that way we can visit the people there. Okay? So that's why each of the numbers of the houses are important. And these in arrays are called the indices, right? So that 1 to 12 that I showed you earlier, those are the names of the variables within the array, and that's how we can find them or go and visit them. So in this case, we have 1 to 8, but we could also have only 3 to 8, and we take 1 and 2 away, right? But now we have a whole group of mansions, but they're all different in size and they would look different, just like how you can put in variables of the same data type, such as string or integer, but they are all different and unique in their own ways. The other thing is we could have an empty plot. For instance, number 6 could actually maybe not be a mansion, it's just a plot of land, but you can build a mansion there. And that happens when you don't allocate a variable to an index in an array. So you can still go and visit the plot, but there won't be anything there. Now the problem with this is if you declare your array and you don't give it a certain value, for instance, you have number 6, but you don't give it a value, then Dolphy would give it an automatic value, which we don't want. So that's why you need to initialize all of the different indices of your variable. Back to Dolphy. All right, let's learn how we can put values into an array. So the first thing you do is you type in the name of the array names, Then you need to say, which number am I going to, right? Just like how when you want to go and visit your friend in an estate, you say, I want to go to number 7, right? So we're going to start with number 1. Okay, we want to go to number 1, and we want to give them a value of Liam. Then we go to number 2, and we want to give them a value of Olivia. And we keep doing that until we have finished assigning values to each of the plots in the array. Now that we have given each of the plots a name, you'll see I've only gone up until 11. And that is because I want to show you what happens if we don't assign a value. Now that we've got values, let's go and visit one of our friends and see what their names are. So we're going to do a show message. And you type in the array name, array names. And let's say we want to visit our third student. And we type in the number 3. Bear in mind that if you're storing integers, then you'll have to do an int to string conversion here. But because we are storing an array of strings, we don't need to do any conversion in the show message. If we run this, and we click on show, then it gives us the value in the third index of the array, which is Noah. If we go back to our code, you can see there, Noah. Awesome stuff. But now, we want to make this even better. So this is our class list. There's only 11 people. And we want the teacher to be able to give the student number, and then the computer program must reply with the student name. So we've got a show button here and a spin edit with a minimum value of 1 and a maximum value of 12, so that the user can't input a number that is outside of our array, because then we will get an error message. So I'm going to make the maximum value 13 so that we can see what exactly would happen. But first we need to do the code. So we're going to get the number, which we're going to call iNumber. It's going to be an integer. And we're going to get it from the spin edit. So iNumber must be assigned the value in the spin edit value. Once we have the value or the number that the teacher wants to find, we can then show this in a message. So instead of putting an actual number, we're going to put in our variable iNumber. Now, every time we click on the button, it's going to show the teacher the name in array names that has the number she has or he has put in. If we run our program now, first one we know is Liam. Let's go to the 10th one. Should be Luke. If we put in the number 13, then we get some random output because we haven't got our array having 13 indices. So it doesn't exist. And if you look, we'll get an error message now. And that is why you need to make sure that when you're dealing with arrays and user input, that they can't ask for an index or a plot of land that doesn't exist, which is why we make the spin edits maximum value 12. So always bear that in mind. If we want to make this a bit cleaner, then we can make the array a private variable, and we can do an onForm activate so that when we open up the program, it then will assign the values to the array. So if we take out all of this here and we put it in the onActivate event, then it's only going to assign the variable values within the array once, and every time we click on the button, it will then still be able to show. So this is better because you only assign the values once and it's done as soon as the program starts. I hope you understand and enjoy the video, and good luck with your future endeavors.